what I believe in. That brings me to the pleasure of introducing Dennis Skinner. I was proud that Dennis launched my election campaign in 2015. We held that meeting in the Irish Centre, and like today, it was a packed meeting and people raring to go to get involved in the campaign. Dennis, even before I met him, was always one of my heroes. Why? Because Dennis Skinner, as a person, as a politician, as almost a force of nature, embodies what we're all about. He embodies the principles of socialism. He embodies the principles of not being told what to do by people who think they're better than people in this league. And he embodies the principles of always saying what he thinks. I love it in Parliament when the Speaker calls Dennis to ask a question. I love it when he's taking on Dodgy Dave. I love it when he's taking on Tedious Theresa. I just want to see him taking on the Tories as our opposition, not the Tories in government. Everyone knows Dennis's story. Unlike lots of MPs, he had a proper job before becoming an MP. That's right, Dennis was a political advisor to... that's someone else. Dennis was a coal miner and a regional leader of the National Union of Mine Workers in Derby. He was a Labour councillor. He was elected as MP for Bolsover. Was it 1970, Dennis?
Yes.
1970. He was elected as MP in 1970. And he's earned the nickname the Beast of Bolsover. He probably is one of the best-known politicians in the whole of the country. He probably is, due to social media, now one of the best-known politicians in a whole host of countries, because people love sharing those clips of him giving the government what for. It's a great, great honour to have Dennis Skinner launching my campaign. It's a great, great honour to have one of the legends of the Labour Party's whole history, one of the legends of the working class movement here with us today, urging us on to campaign here in East Leeds. Can we all give the biggest possible East Leeds welcome?
I'm looking at a sea of angry faces. They're all Tories, of all hues and descriptions. They think I'm looking at them, but I fix my eyes on a blank piece of the wall behind Dodgy Dave or Tedious Theresa. He stole that from me. She is boring, isn't she? I see these polls about 60% of the population love her and this time the other. God almighty, what's happened to Britain if that's true? For of course nobody in here has ever been stopped by one of these opinion pollers, have you?
No.
No, I've never found one. I mean, they'd not stop me either. I don't think they would, even if they thought about it. But the reason why I'm here is principally because of his uncle, Colin, who started these proceedings earlier today. Because he invited me to go to Elmet when he was the MP for the area. And of course there was a bit there, Leicester Luck, amongst others. And I had been a miner for many years before I went to the Palace of Varieties. I'll tell you something, it's an easier job than working in the pit. You'd better believe it. I'm not one of those MPs that talks in a romantic way about being underground. Because most of the people that talk in a romantic way have never been down one. It was slavery. But there was something about the camaraderie down the pit that I don't think you can buy anything. You certainly couldn't get it in the House of Commons. It's one of the most competitive places I've ever been in. I mean, they steal your lines. I mean, I've not mentioned about the snap election and about the fact that Theresa May had had a kind of a fairy story revelation on the Snowdonia Hills, and she decided to call a snap election in order to get over the Brexit problem. I'll tell you now, she never had Brexit while she's been there. So what's the trouble? I mean, that's a bigger majority than she's got. It's only 17, but those people from the Ulster Unionists and the DUP turn up into her lobby almost every time. So the idea that somehow or other she had to stop the deadlock, I've not noticed it. And I've been there for 46 years. I mean, there was a cop. She was winning the votes hands down. And so it's a load of crap, so I decided to find out why she called a snap election. And it's pretty clear. We're still fighting the remnants of the 2015 election. And I happened to be witness to it in the Tesco car park in Amber Valley, which was a Tory marginal seat. And the Tory MP candidate that was standing against me approached me, a little lad, and he said, "I'm the Conservative candidate for Bolton." I said, "Well, I'm not mayor, and I don't know who you are, and if you say you are, well, that's it. What are you doing here? It's not Bolton, it's Amber Valley." And he said, "Well, we helped it out in this marginal seat," and he blew the gaff, really. And then he went to a crowd of people, and I unknowingly didn't realise there was a battle bus in the background. But I soon found out. Because Amber Valley was one of those marginal seats that the Tories were scared stiff of losing. And they didn't put the money for the battle bus. And all those people that were staying at the hotels on the election register. And not only was it happening in Amber Valley, but it was happening in the 29 other seats. And suddenly, the Director of Public Prosecutions made a statement saying that they were going to release the names of the people concerned and would be charged accordingly before the end of, say it, June. That's why there's an election. So I told her to her face, because that Burko, for the first time ever, after I accused Cameron of being dodgy Dave, which he is, and he never called me to the Prime Minister's question time after that. Because I told him I'd been using dodgy Dave several times and he'd obviously not noticed. It was because we were discussing money on the day he threw me out. I actually called him dodgy Dave in relation to be making money on the side, or at least his family was, and not paying tax. That's another thing we're going to do when we get back into power, and that's why Murdoch and all the rest of them are saying all these nasty things about the Labour Party, because they're scared stiff that when we get off the tax evasion and tax avoidance and use the money for the people and they probably ring Murdoch. I suppose he's an argent provocateur, journalist. They usually, you find him in a black cap at my meeting. Oh, he looks a bit out of place because he's buying from Arabs. So they'll be able to say what I've said already, and I've said it in Parliament. And I told them to their face that those candidates that are now being examined by the Director of Public Prosecutions should not be allowed to stand in this election. And so the reason why I'm supporting Richard, and I've done it right from the beginning, is because of that meeting with his uncle, when he came along as a young student with a camera, and he was doing things with that camera that they do now on social media. I don't know much about it, the social media. I've never sent an email in my life, because I'll tell you now, MPs want to be careful about getting involved in sending emails, because those right-wing journalists down there in the Palace of Varieties are reading them all. And that's why 10 ministers or shadow ministers have already had the sack for saying things on the social media. So they're not catching Skinner. Because they infest those places as well. They're all over the place. And so my advice today to Richard, I've not given him this before, don't go in. I've never been in the parliamentary bars for 46 years or whatever it is, and I don't feel any the worse of trips abroad. They go on fact-finding tours and they finish up with the Australian Test match. All the fact-finding tours are between the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn. They never go fact-finding to Greenland in the winter. Isn't it funny? So I don't do that either. That means I'm there every day. What's wrong with that? To get up the noses of those Tories and the tinpot Liberals and the Scott National dare to take my seat. They've got to get up in the morning to catch me. I put a prayer card in every morning. Me. Prayer. I don't go into prayer. But I get up. And the Scott Nats found out after about a fortnight they couldn't keep pace. By the way, every time you go up, you know, they talk about Scott. I mean, it's just like Richard standing up talking about Leeds. It's like me talking about Garbage. We don't do that. We're talking to the working class in any part of Britain or any part of the world. That's what we are. And there's always a call to be fighting for in Parliament. Every day of the week. You can't be an MP in your own backyard. And some of them do that. And we have to make sure that we elect people like Richard here to fight for these seats in order that we know that when they get there, they're going to not only talk like a socialist, they're going to act like a socialist and go to the voting lobbies accordingly. Sometimes it's heavy lifting, but you have to do it. And we're here because the Labour Party was formed by the trade union movement. The turn of the last century didn't take the trade union as long to find out that there are a lot of people in Parliament, Lib Labs and all sorts of fancy names, for like the SDP later on. Shirley Poppins and Dr. Death. Boy of the Wannicles. There's always been some people infiltrating the Labour Party when they've not really done what they should do, and that's fight for working class people and their families from day one until the very end. That's what we're there for. And that's why the trade union said we want some workers in Parliament. And that's why I'm there. Because I went straight from the pits, straight into Parliament. And I'm proud of it.
They
They wouldn't move an inch and they wouldn't plead contempt of court. And do you know what happened the following day? And that's why you should remember this when you see the opinion polls and you see that we're way down and all the rest of it and you think nothing else can happen. What really happened was the Tory government had to abandon the Trade Union Relations Act, kick it into the long grass, get the six doctors out of jail, and I forecast when I got banned from Bentonville, I says they'll be in the strangers' bar boozing with the journalist before he can bat their eye, and they were. That's how things can change. That day told me that almost anything can happen if you've got the will to fight. That's for me. And that's why, when I think about the people concerned about the polls, I remember 1945. And we were born a long time ago. I spent my time, after 10 years of age, taking out newspapers during the war. I used to read every one. It was all about the war. And I said to my dad, what will you print in the papers, Dad, when the war was over? He said, a lot of reading rubbish. So I was raving. And I said to him, I'm fed up of seeing that Churchill in his boiler suit and his fee sign and his cigar. Nearly every Sunday when I take the egg pie news out, can you remember that one? No, you can't. That was the top seller. More than the news of the world, and the news of the world went on to owned by Murdoch then. No. The war told me about a lot of things in my short political life. And I said to my dad, I see this Churchill. What was that man? He says, it's a good man. He's got few words. His name is Clem Attlee. But he's got some bloody good people around him. Jeremy acts with him. Tesco safe. They go to somebody else's safe and take it out of there. That's how capitalism works. I'd like to think it was different, but that's it. And so when we do all the things that we've promised, and we've got a 10-point plan like we had in 1945, it's a lot of things like we've got to repair the National Health Service, haven't we?
Yes.
We've got to stop the people being on the trolley beds and all the rest of it. We've also got to do something about social care, haven't we?
Yes.
We should have a Robin Hood tax on speculation. We've not started on that yet, but I'm campaigning here in Leeds. A Robin Hood tax to provide social care for everybody in Britain.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what we did with the National Health Service when Gordon Brown was the Chancellor. And at one point he did something exceptionally sensible. When the National Health Service was starved at pubs, and in 1997 the amount of money we spent on the NHS was £33 billion. Remember, these figures are very important. By the time Gordon Brown left office in 2010, 13 years later, in real terms, the money going to the National Health Service because of him introducing 1% increase on the national insurance tax, sending every penny to the National Health Service, meant that it rose to £100 billion. That was the Labour legacy. And suddenly, after not gone into that bloody stupid war in Iraq, they'll be talking about it forever. And that's what we're going to do in that time. We're going to make sure that we do what they did in 45. We're going to make sure that we deal with workers' pay. You've heard about the gig economy and zero-hour contracts. We're going to get rid of them. We're going to take all the rail. The man that's doing all the work, so we're going to do it. And then we're going to stop the deregulations of the bus services in Leeds and Baltimore. We're not going to do those things. They're all party policy. All of them. That's what we're going to do. And that's what we committed to, just like my dad said. It'll be done by good people around the Prime Minister. So when he got his job, I was proud of him. He deals with justice. He's a lawyer. He's not a minor like me. He knows the subject inside out. He can even play the piano.
That was a secret.
Yeah, I found that out. And we've got others like him. Or young stars in the making. Aided and abetted by Dave Anderson. Or when the Progress Party people left, he did two jobs, one on Scotland and one on Northern Ireland. And boy, did he do that. Did he used to stir up the DUP and the Ulster Union? Yeah. The idea that somehow or other we haven't got the talent in order to fill all these positions like they did in 1945, hardly any of them had ever served in government before. And they did all those wonderful things. And after 5 years, the Labour government had an unemployment rate with all those people coming out of the forces. They said it would be of astronomical heights. It would have to 2.2%. Can you believe it? And being churches. So if a government can do that, with the help of the working class of Leeds and Bolsover, and everywhere else, we can do it again. So she's called a snap election on the basis that she wanted to outwit the Director of Public Prosecutions. And so now, it's not only me shouting the odds, Nicola Sturgeon, Alex Salmond, they all jump on the back of me. Remember, you've heard it face to you and anybody else that does. And so if the Director of Public Prosecutions does decide that 30 people are going to be charged, or not even charged, but consider being charged, that will be enough to prove my point. So that's why, another reason, I'm here today. I enjoy fighting the enemy. There's nothing else finer to do than to get stuck in every day. And boy, have I been lucky. The NHS has saved my life twice. I've had cancer, I've had a heart bypass, I've had a hip replacement, and I can still walk backwards. Not that I do that. I want to thank you for backing him at the beginning, because he is one of the stars of the future. He is one of the people that I'm proud to be here. He's the man who stood with his camera and then produced the 20th anniversary of the pig miners' strike, which was an example to anybody. He must be proud of that work, just as he is of many other things that he turns his hand to. But when he stands up at justice questions and flattens a Tory who's not all that bright, but he still flattens you with all your thoughts, if you're up against and like Sandra Fontaine, think about this is easy, he doesn't, he pulls the knife in. That's what I like from our side. So he gave me a lot of reasons to be here today. But I'll tell you now, whatever else happens, and I think with a 6-week campaign, we can do better than be talking about Brexit every day of the week. My view is it'll be like Teddy in 1974, when he decided, some of you will remember, a lot of you will remember here, he said it's the miners on strike versus me. Well, it was for a day or two. Well, then it changed. And the election became an issue about the NHS. And he said, well, it's between the mines and me. And then it became an issue about wages generally. Then it became an issue about schools. Then it became an issue about all sorts of things that take place in any election campaign. And then after about a fortnight, the polls begin to change. It was no longer Ted Heath versus the miners. It was Ted Heath that hadn't got the answers for the future government that he hoped to lead. That's what we have to do in this election campaign. Turn it into an issue, not about Brexit. As I said earlier, she'd never had a majority of less than 30 anyway. She never had a revelation or a fairy story. She knew that if she stayed in office without an election, she'd lose her majority. And Skinner and his mates, Richard Burgon, would go to town. That's what could have happened. So that's the revelation. That's the Leeds revelation. You all know now what I was up to. That's what it's about. And that's why in this long 6-week programme we have to divert attention away from the grounds of she wants to fight the election and do what we did in 1974, when finally, as a result of the campaign by Harold Wilson and me, people like you in Leeds and anywhere else, we shifted it, and then Wilson became leader of the largest party. And then we formed a government, and he had another election in October and got a majority, and they lasted for 5 years. That's what we have to do this time. Make sure that we campaign on the issues that we want. The issues that we've talked about today, and about trade unions in particular. This is an army that's going to go on the streets at Leeds and tell the people of Leeds that this snap election
must not give a big majority to Theresa May, because if they do, it will be the privatisation of the NHS, it will be more grammar schools, it will be bigger even cuts for the Labour authorities in every town and city, and believe me, she'll do anything, because she's not all that principled in mind. So let's get to work. And it means that after all the clapping has subsided, and after all the cheering, we get on the streets and we talk to the people in this long campaign and deliver a working class Labour government committed to a 10-point plan which will make the Tories hair curl. Thank you very much.